Color management matters to open source and to you. So just to cover some of what color management is, the basics are to get what you see is what you get. What color you want to, you think you're going to have show up. That's it. It's very simple, but it is definitely not easy, and that is the difference. If you don't know what you're doing, it takes a lot of steps to make that happen correctly. And in the past, the perception had been that it's only for certain professionals, esoteric experts, the mathematicians, the ivory tower people, who knows, I don't care. What we have is that many people really need it but don't realize they do. We'll go over some of the detail elsewhere, other times, different places, but one of the biggest ones is businesses, home users, and companies online. These are some of the guys who really overlook it. They think they're not graphic professionals. They don't have to worry about it. But in among other things, business deals can be lost by you getting the color of the logo wrong for the company you're trying to pitch your services to. Doesn't seem like very much, but if the person you're trying to pitch to, being a vendor contact, has a very high chance of being the same person or one of the people who dealt with the consulting company that did the graphic design of their logo to begin with, and who spent back and forth 6 months and hundreds of revisions, literally, to get the exact color of puce they needed on their logo. And if you come out with magenta, you've lost the job. First few seconds, you're going to have that. Home users have digital needs, photos, prints, books coming out now, even more and more has come up. And then any company selling product over the net. Traditionally, the number one reason for return of online sales items has been color. When they buy the sweater, they love it, it shows up, they open the box, it's fuchsia, not magenta. They return it. Big money drain right there. Now, other operating system vendors have had long-running solutions, but this is where in the free world, X11 and Linux especially have been way behind. The approaches to color management, these are some just terms I came up with to try to classify them offhand. Most basic one is eyeball it. You tune your monitor until it looks pretty. Then you tweak your colors until they're printing out on your inkjet printer, right? Then you think, okay, good, I've got to send it off somewhere. You're done. Then there's kind of ad hoc methods where you twiddle with white balance. If you're doing a video, you might hit the white balance button on your video camera. Or if you're a photographer, you might have a card that is black and white. You put it on where you're going to take a shoot, take a picture of that. Then when you go in your digital darkroom, you can hit your blacks and your whites and come up. Or you might get a color reference card. Some of these are pretty common where you have 16 or 36 or however many colors. You set it where your still life is going to be or where your model is going to be sitting. Take the shot, so then later when you go back to tweak your shots afterwards, you'll have the reference for color. Then the final one is really measured, where you have calibration targets, you have hardware, you have really precise, accurate information where it's been scientifically measured and matched. Question that most people have is, do you need color management? As a user or programmer, mainly even as a user of a computer, you probably do, but don't realize it. One question is, if you have multiple displays, if you're doing photo printouts, if you're purchasing things online, as I mentioned, there's a big hit there. If you're sharing images with someone, you're going to send the family photos off to grandma who couldn't make the reunion, and she says, is little Timmy really that shade of green? He needs to get out more. So you need some kind of color management if you have eyes and a computer. Or even not. If you're contributing to OSS, open source software, you probably need to factor in something. Even if you're, like I've worked with photographers and programmers who are colorblind, they still can put in the right hooks and make the right things happen. So one of the first questions I hit is multiple displays. So how many people here have multiple displays they're dealing with at home? good, maybe a six, a quarter at most, okay. Except, so we're talking about, probably most people think they have multi-monitors. You buy a second monitor, hook it up to your computer, you look good. So that's probably who we have there. But really, this is what we're dealing with now in the current times. You have a second computer you're using also as a display. Sometimes I run this presentation with a Linux AE PC plugged into the projector with this remote using the X11 so that I could be sure to hook up and do full screen with no problems as we encountered here. Quick, no-nonsense setup, but so to simplify myself giving presentations, I use two computers often. Cell phone, PDA, iPhone, Android, any of those that do pictures you care about. TV, HDMI inputs, this laptop works great plugged into my 42-inch TV at home. And it's a higher resolution than the laptop screen itself, so I can do more programming on it if I can ever steal it away from my family. MP3 player, you know, iPod Touch, a bunch of the others. Digital picture frames, we have those last Christmas time in my local drugstore. They had 8 different digital picture frames just sitting up on the wall for me to pick from. And the price at Costco and some other club stores have come down to decent resolution ones for less than $50 US a piece. So they're really common. Projectors, number one thing for people doing any kind of presentation, anything like that. If you get a color you want it to show up, I picked a blue that's actually a blue that usually comes up okay, but it's not what you see there. It's not what I'm seeing here. And it's definitely not what's showing up on this other monitor here. Projector, toaster, I've checked. How many people think a toaster is not a valid computer output device?
Not yet.
There are at least 3 computer output toasters available out there, including plans for one at Mad Scientist Laboratories online. So that is valid. I have checked. So now, how many people think they have multiple displays they have to deal with? Yeah, almost everyone then, or a lot more people. So the good news is that the devices that can accurately do better color that are even worth bothering trying to get displays out of are easier to get a hold of. Cameras that can take good pictures, high-res pictures. Video cameras, HD, it's consumer level is really available now. End-user expectations are increasing. So instead of being amazed that they can get a handheld thing that can actually capture some video, those days are gone. Now users are trying to get a camera that takes a good picture and a video that shoots real video, not this blue-green washed-out mess they've been used to. And then also collaboration across many open source projects is coming together. We have various things give and take. Scribus has now started being able to pull in the color manage SVGs that Inkscape just started putting in. We still have a lot more ground to go, especially to make it usable. Now, a lot of developer momentum came together at the original LGM, where Marty Maria came and presented the little CMS library, and everyone started picking up from that. GIMP was the first one, I think, that really got a really good solution based around that out and delivered, and I think did a really amazing job given what they had and what they typed. So before and after is really pulled together. This was a more generic presentation before, but for mainly developers and users and graphics, ICC profiles, they're key. If you don't know what they are, go look up. You need to know more detail. So now, one of the things on multi-monitor support is it is pretty tricky if you're trying to get more than a single monitor calibrated. There are vendor-specific extensions, there's Xenorama, there's R&R, there's all sorts of things, but you need to basically profile, measure what you have, adjust it to be as close to optimal output as you can, and then fetch it at runtime to see what you do have so you can have it work and get the best reply or presentation. Taking a moment? Okay, a moment. CMYK. This I push because I think this is the biggest objection graphics professionals I've seen have to accepting open source software is they'll just, even if they never actually do any CMYK, if they come up and say, well, Illustrator is CMYK, this doesn't, GIMP doesn't, whatever, I can't use it. I can't use it for work. Wait a minute. But you never do prints, color separations. Well, it's an excuse. So this is what we need, is that, first of all, to understand technically, there is no single CMY color space. You need CMYK that's managed with some workflow so that you can target a specific printer or type of printer or close. It's not like sRGB, which is a generic, covers most everything thing, or lab, which is absolute accurate color. It's four color numbers that happen to make a color happen on this printer that may not happen on that one. Now, for application level, RGB is simple. You have three numbers in, three numbers out. It's been done forever. It's what monitors do. It's simple. Now, poor CMYK is almost as simple. That's the problem. We want good CMYK. So you need color management. That's just, I'm using CM, and a workflow to allow users to do that. That's probably what took GIMP more than a few weeks to add support for it in, is that if it's not usable, people just can't make it happen, can't do anything with it. Color management and open source, a little history lesson. Okay, we're done. You don't care so much about history, we need to move forward, especially most people are at least aware of what some of the graphics apps are. What we care is to hit them widely and know where to go forward. Some of them, Cinepeng was one of the first, Scribus does really good print output, print work professional, Krita, SK1, GIMP, Inkscape is one of the latter of those to add something. We've got at least base compensation in there and images are corrected as of a couple of revisions ago. But we need to pull up and move forward more and more. So, pausing a moment for the tools where the developers, that's where, and savvy users need Argyle or Arenos. If you're not familiar with those are projects that are a color management system end-to-end to take your profiles, to manage them, to catalog them, to apply them, to use them, the whole end-to-end. LProf will let you create profiles as needed. It works pretty well and is handy. And then XICC is something that GIMP, Inkscape and maybe a few others have been supporting. It allows you to attach a profile to a display or multiple displays if you need to in X, so that when you run an application remotely, like I often do, it will be able to find the right profile for what it's appearing on. And I think one of the main ones I'm aware of, which was presented at the original CMS, or little original LGM, is little CMS. It's small, it's really easy, it's distributed with most distros, at least some version. It's got a very simple API. If you're working with image buffers, it's not too difficult. You know how to handle a file already, you can feed it a file. Okay, you're good. They take care of all the tricky math and transformations and all that, and it is literally easy to integrate. Once I learned about it at the LGM presentation, I came back, sat down, digested everything that happened at LGM. That took me a week. Then I started trying to do this in Inkscape. It took me a week, and then I had it working, and images in Inkscape were color managed and corrected. The workflow wasn't in because I didn't have a UI and everything else, but it's really very easy to use. Going over just some of the other tools, Scribus, is a very good professional workflow for print. Some drawbacks for SVG. It needs to support SVG better as opposed to just dropping it all together. We've been coordinating with them. The first commits have actually gone in to make this happen. So where I say it's planned, not only is it planned, the check-ins actually are happening. And there's some info they have on that on notes. And then I have the GIMP notes on there also because their page on it does a good job of explaining. So as of fall 2007, GIMP support for color management came in pretty well. Lets you set RGB and CMYK working profiles, which I typoed there, sorry. Does the workflow pretty well, pretty nice. Displays profiles, soft proofing, doesn't really do mixing image color spaces because that's something weird and obscure, but if you don't even need to know you do it, or if you don't know that you need it, you probably don't even miss it.
Come on, John, it's not that obscure. But you do need to, you need to architect it right.
Yes.
Otherwise it becomes very hard to do.
Yes.
If you convert everything on input to the output color space, then you can't do it.
Yes, so if it's easy, multiple color spaces, managing them, you have to manage them right. If it's easy to do it poorly. It's difficult to do it well, but once you do it well, it's going to really benefit a lot of people. Inkscape, of course, I know a lot more about because I actually work on it. The good thing for us is that SVG has the explicit or implicit working color space defined as sRGB. So we're already color managed by the spec we're based on. So if we pull those in, we pull them out, there, we've done our job. 255 is 255. I just hope your display system displays it correctly. For 044 was the version that had that base image. So if you have an image placed and you attach an ICC profile to it, it'll adjust it according to that profile when it goes. For 046, we've added display adjustment, soft proofing, and some CMS color selection where you can actually, if you have a six-channel profile, you can use six color sliders to pick your colors. It will give you an RGB fallback, but it will place these colors and it will store them and round trip them so that they are preserved. Prior to this, when Inkscape gave you a CMYK slider, it would let you slide the four values, but once you quit Inkscape or close that document and open up, it had converted everything to RGB three values and you lost all your separation. This will now preserve that between in saves in a way that's completely compliant with the SVG 1.1 spec. For web graphics, most end users do not have corrected displays. PC versus Mac, maybe 10% difference, too dark, too light. We don't know.
Just trying to understand why applications need color management. This is a problem of displays. If you set up a color management profile for your display, shouldn't the applications deal with display transparently?
For the most part, should this just be a display problem and not have the applications have to deal with it? Well, on Linux, if the application doesn't deal with it, nothing does it. On Windows, there are some base workarounds and the OS do it, and then on Mac OS, you have the actual color management calls built into the OS forever that the applications are using, so they do get it. But on Linux, the applications have to do at least something. Now, if nothing else, you have sRGB, where the application can say, we work in sRGB. So as long as they adjust to a display profile when present, then everything else is up to the user. Now, if you're a web developer or a web designer, you have to know that a lot of your end users aren't going to have it right. But if you've done your job, you can know, oh, if that purple is not really purple, you need to tune your screen. Right now, if you don't know, it might be your screen's off. You can't tell the end users to do it. So there's at least a minimum level that's needed, if nothing else, to call out our numbers are sRGB. Not under X11. The drivers, they can be loaded with gamma correction and everything else, but the actual precise color matching, like on a Mac OS call, you don't get for free in Linux. The high-end commercial applications handle all that for you. If you're working at ILM or Pixar, you have that. But in the free realm, we don't. So that's kind of the problem, is it wouldn't be that hard to at least add basic display adjustment, but the apps have to add it in Linux.
And one more thing, I deal with designing models in Blender and assigning materials, and I find that after a lot of Googling, there's no information on RGB content of even most common materials. There's no information whatsoever. I end up just having to do it by eye.
Yeah. So there are certain things that can be done to get the color of a material, but one of the things is that sometimes it's related to your viewing conditions and the lighting in the room, and under different viewing conditions you'll get different colors, but if you have a end-to-end workflow, what you can do, you can point your camera, digital camera at it, take a shot, it'll be color managed, you'll know exactly what the numbers are so you can create the right numbers in Blender to get the right output. But if you don't know every single step along your pipeline is correct, you'll don't know how many of them are broken. Not if one, but how many are. Now, when you were working, like I said, web profile is easy if you're only targeting web, you work in sRGB, you preview with the average Mac and PC views to make sure you're at least in the ballpark, but hey, that's as close as they're going to get, so don't worry beyond that. What is the S for sRGB? Is it standard? Yeah, standard. So it was a best guess average of what display devices targeting at the time will get you in the ballpark. If you don't have a precise consumer need for something more accurate, it's supposed to try to do the job. Now, when you go to print output, this is where you're going to have some other problems where you're... And especially in an SVG document, you can literally have different ICC color profiles living side by side in the same document very easily. One of the simplest is, say, first example I got someone gave me was a magazine. They're doing a fancy print run where the cover actually has a cutout. And so the picture is on the glossy front cover and also on the matte first page. And they want the color to be the same on both. That's the kind of thing print designers want to be able to do, and Inkscape has to be able to do that because it's the vector-based aspect of that. We're not tuning up a photo, which would be part of it or something. And then a print operation might do that more than some other things, or a publishing tool maybe. And then a proofing profile is very, very useful because then you can simulate the colors you're going to have and know which colors you can see on screen but just won't print out ever. Which they are there, and they do that. Inkscape for mobile devices is another good point for color management, especially I've seen some places where you might want to preview, what does it look like on this phone in the dark with the backlight on? What does it look like in the sun with the backlight off? You know, if you can run through these very simply and very quickly, that's a whole realm of user need that you can cover. Now, cross-application integration. What we really want is as many applications as possible should be managed. So as was mentioned, it's just a display issue. People don't have to worry about it. End users don't have to worry about it. Once they're done, they're done. Now, there's many more support color management than in 2005 when things started. And OpenICC is an umbrella group of software, GIMP, Scribus, Argal, Arenos, Inkscape, all who are kind of getting together to try to come under and address this. So what do we need to do next? Developers need to add support, and users need to ask for support. If you don't have an integrated color managed workflow between your applications, ask them why. Or no, ask them when is it coming in? Not if, not why, but when. And how are we doing on time here? Okay, so I'll go through very quickly. I had some samples. I'll skim through. The main thing I'm trying to show is that you take a picture of something. Here, the camera didn't quite capture the color right. When you imported it, you don't have it imported right. Then when you adjust the colors, you think you fixed it to match, but then the end user, you know, you got an apple, you took a picture of a tomato, but the end user sees a lemon. You know, common problem, that's that kind of thing. And now, these slides I have up available online, and I'm going to be doing more of these examples as time goes, so we'll skim past all of those. And throw up a quick little technical item was some ICC profiles. So here are screenshots of four different profiles I grabbed and being displayed under utility on an OS to be named later. We need to fix some of the open source tools to be able to do this for us better. Now, looking at all those, they seem, in the ballpark, fairly similar. It's a little hard to tell the difference between them. So I went and overlaid a couple. So here's my laptop, I have a colorimeter hooked to my laptop, measured what range of colors it can produce, hooked it to the other things, you know, measured everything around my house. So my external analog LCD monitor can show a lot more colors physically than my laptop can. So I can't see the greenest green or the bluest blue or the yellowest yellow on this laptop. But if I have it hooked to the external monitor, I can. So if I do something pure yellow, it's going to look very different when I move from one screen to the other. So now here's one interesting thing. I compared my laptop screen to my HDMI input on my HDTV. Pretty common nowadays, and much less expensive than they used to be, and it's pretty much all that you can get now. It's not like plasma where only a few people had them. This is just an LCD TV. The shape of what the LCD is even slightly different. It's blues, but there's a little corner down there that the blues on my laptop, the TV can't quite reproduce, but everything else, the TV can show me far more. So I'm not going to see the right image if I'm targeting television. Now, this is what really bugged me and surprised me when I saw it, was that the colored one is the profile of display range of my laptop. The gray one, in this case, is the display range of sRGB. My laptop can't cover huge portions of sRGB. So I think I'm using sRGB, but I'm not. But if I don't have this calibrated and compensated for, I can't know that I'm not really seeing the greenest green of sRGB. Or down at the purple range, that's where it's really missed. Although my laptop can show me more yellows and blues. And then here's just a comparison with the shape. So in the gray profile now is showing what the abstract generic CMYK can print, which is very different than what my laptop can show me. So there's some colors that won't print and some colors on print that I can't see on the screen. And then finally, to the point about CMYK not being really being a single color space, the colored one is now the generic CMYK, which I claim isn't a real color space, it's just some random pseudo thing. The gray one is the color space of the printer on my shelf, which you can see here, it's actually a different shape, the curves are convex instead of concave, and you know the color ranges are all very different. So if you really want to care about those edge cases, you have to measure. And then, here we go. Now, I'll make a note that I have these slides up as a presentation with full notes on all the pages so we can go over in general. But, so if you have more questions, in general, you might review them to see what comes up. But now, more specifically, are there any questions here now? Uh-oh, I see who's asking it. Hey, at least Marty isn't here, I'm safe.
Just a quick question about the diagrams you just showed. What is this actually looking at? I don't understand the diagrams directly. So this obviously is some view on the color cube. And I can explain it. Okay.
So you said it's viewing a color cube, kind of, but in that case, all of them would look like a cube, right?
Yeah, right.
So what this is CIELAD color space, so the lightness axis is pointing out of the screen towards you, which is why you see the white colors at
okay.
the top, and then it's the A and B axes, with the axes there. So what you're seeing is a top view of a three-dimensional surface in CIELAD color space. Obviously, to get this idea, you need to scroll it around and look at it from underneath and so on.
Okay.
Yeah, and so all these shots I've taken are from a three-dimensional view that, as Chris mentioned, you can grab and rotate and spin this to view. It's actually a 3D shape showing you that mapping and visualizing it. And
John, could you hold just on there? You see this yellow and then the orangey orange is somehow brighter, and that's because that shape is actually clipping, it's pointing out of the gray shape, so you can see it more easily because there's a gray net over the rest of it. So that tells you that in that case the sRGB space is sticking out above the other one. So you've got two arbitrary polygon shapes, one enclosed inside the other, and sort of sticking out. That's what we're looking at. And the more saturated colors are towards the outside, and the neutral colors are towards the middle, and the central axis is white to gray to black. And unfortunately, there are no real good tools under Linux that can give you that sort of display. You can get that. That's the macOS tool. There's a similar one for Windows you can download.
There is another Reynolds-based tool that displays 3D threads.
Oh, you can convert to
and
PR
it also does the rotating stuff.
Okay.
Yeah.
In Reynolds?
It's using RS.
Yeah. There is at least one that's coming in, but it's still not as functional as this tool. So, again, this is another case where open source is close. So if you have just even a little interest to poke around this for a couple days and you like 3D, there you go. You can help us out that way. So, other questions?
Questions? Because we're recording.
So it's just a comment, and one of the big problem when you're doing something remotely is your eye will interpret the colors depending on the ambient color around. And so one trick is you make your image that matters fairly small, and then around that you provide colors that would then help your eye to calibrate.
Mm-hmm.
So you set the colors up, it's around your image such that your eye has a predictable kind of a light, right? So it's the same problem you have when you're doing video, right? If I'm in a fairly dark studio and I'm trying to do video, I'll get the color wrong every time because my eye is adjusting to the ambient, not to the whatever is on the screen is interpreted by my brain.
Yes, so that's
because of the ambient.
Yeah.
So you have to, if you can provide your main image fairly small and then provide some light coming from the monitor in different colors, then your eye will better job interpreting what it sees.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and that goes to, I touched on a little earlier, it all depends on the viewing conditions. So it's not just that picture, like you said, if it's surrounded with the ambient light, either the lighting in the room or your monitor or the angle, or and you can, by doing a border around your image, you can control some of that ambient perception. And it is all perceptual, it's very subjective. And if you understand the factors that come into that, that's good. And then now, if anyone has any interest in the details of that and what may or may not help and be a good UI, one of the things is for Inkscape, our one Google Summer of Code project is to improve the CMYK workflow, which is mainly going to be about user interface and preview and profiling. There's a little bit of output, but the guts are in there. So we're to that point now where that sort of thing, where being able to preview with different ambient surrounding pixels might be really helpful, things like that. And so we have that kicking off next week or week after. So if anyone's interested in either participating or just following, watching it, that's a project that we're doing openly under that, which is I think is really helpful that Google can do that. Well, is anyone else? So wouldn't it be more efficient, which?
To fork X11 and just fix the problem.
Oh, okay. Carl Worth gave a good presentation at LinuxConf AU, which I think has been on video, where he presented up the details of the stack of different places in the drawing program and started to explain how they go together and what's calling what when, and it was like the end of the most complex football play you've ever seen being analyzed on screen with the sportscasters. from what I can tell at the moment, it's not X11's job to do this, and it can't do it well, and it shouldn't try to do it right now. It's not that the X11 developers are copying out and saying, oh, we don't want to do that. It's like, okay, here's the details, and that actually fits outside of us or below us, and you have to either add new pipelines top to bottom into X that are designed correctly to be able to hold up, or you have to do this end around where you have you poke the drivers, you have X does have mechanisms to let us get at the details at runtime, so an app can ask the X11 display for the details without X having any code changed. But it really is more of an application level problem at this time. So yeah, no need to go mob and attack the X11 developers. I definitely agree with their position. They have that right. All right, well, thank you very much. Sorry for it being a little rushed, but as I said, the slides and everything up are online, so you can get a little more information as you need it. Thank you for your time.